Hi there. In Europe, female directors have a tough time getting their movies noticed on the festival scene. And that notion is backed up by a new study that says, like many places in the world, Europe has a diversity problem.
Swedish director Amanda Kernell says she makes films to explore topics that are hard to talk about. That includes divorce and child custody in her movie Charter. But women in Europe don't get to tell their stories enough, according to a new study. The European Audiovisual Observatory reported that women are underrepresented in Europe's film industry. The research covers a period between 2016 and 2020. During that time, only a quarter of Europe's film directors were female, with even fewer women getting jobs as cinematographers and composers. But it's not that women don't want to make movies. Antonetta Castrati made a film about a young Albanian woman coping with the trauma of war while also trying to conceive a child. And then there's the Finnish drama, Force of Habit. Krisika Saari and Eli Toivonemi's effort to describe the sexual harassment that women face every day. All these films did get a spot at a film festival in Australia. The Sydney Film Festival partnered with an organization that promotes European films abroad.
I did feel that it's just so wonderful that there is such a pool of talent, like literally an army of female talent that is helping the process of putting in practice what gender equality agenda really means.
Some positive strides are being made in Europe. The Berlin, London, and Venice film festivals have made commitments to gender equality and inclusion, but they've stopped short at accepting calls for quotas for female directors.
If you ask me if that makes me happy, introducing quotas, no. But I don't see any other way for starting to force this industry into thinking differently and consider films directed by women in another way.
Quotas or not, female directors don't just want the spotlight at European film festivals. They're looking for the money and support to tell the stories that only they can. And as it stands now, the financial scales continue to tip in favor of the guys.
Professor Mary Harrod joins me now. She's at the University of Warwick and focuses on contemporary film and gender identity. Hi there, Mary. Welcome to Showcase. So, well, seems that gender parity is still a long way off for the European film industry. Were you surprised to see the report?
Yes and no. I know how tenacious these issues are. On the other hand, the figures are really very disappointing, with only 23% of commercial films directed by women, up only 1% from the previous study in 2018. And it flies in the face of the EU's gender equality strategy. Not only that, but we've had the Weinstein affair in 2017 and then similar scandals in Europe, which are about more than sexual abuse in film industries. They're about a culture of corruption and the worst kind of boys club. And that's not going to change until we see women as creators behind the camera more fully and not only objects in front of it.
Well, I want to talk about what could be done to change this picture, but then let's read into the report now. I see that women are better represented in documentaries than action or animated films. Why is this the case?
You are absolutely right. And I think the immediate answer is to do with budgets. I think this is one of the problems, the barriers to entry for women. There's a fear to allow them control over these huge sums of money. I mean, there are anecdotes from Hollywood. Nancy Meyer, who's now directing the most profitable films by women in Hollywood, talks about how in 1979, when she co-wrote a film, Private Benjamin, with her husband, she wasn't even allowed on the set. It was a clause in her contract. She had to be accompanied by him or another producer. They were obviously scared she was going to upset things somehow. Documentaries are often seen as more personal as well. I mean, they can be, and that does sometimes attract women. There's a particular tradition of women making that kind of work. But I think really it's structural, and it's the budget.
Okay. Well, we also see in the report that female actors are seen more than female directors. So it's 39% to 23%. Is this good news? Is this something to be less pessimistic about?
I mean, it's true that some praises of the report have presented this as a relatively positive thing, that 39% of lead actors are female. But I would definitely put caveats on that. It depends what kind of roles. I mean, there are observable consistencies in the fact that if you want to have varied and three-dimensional roles for women, a lot of the time there's going to be a female-led creative team. There are exceptions. But unfortunately, there's just a long history of men making films in which women were the object, the decoration, rather than agency on the screen or behind the camera.
I don't know if it's just me being too skeptical, but then no one would say out loud that women should be looked at but not heard. But then this is pretty much what the industry is doing. Don't you think?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. I do. And I think it's sad. I mean, it's not the only industry, but there are particularly high stakes here because, you know, it is where we draw our ideas of legitimate identity norms from, the audiovisual landscape, basically.
Mary, do you believe that there are stories that only women can tell?
I don't personally believe that. Otherwise, you know, it's not a creative project. However, I think what we do need is positive discrimination. So it would be nice to see women telling women's stories. You know, I think that there are concrete measures that can be taken to address this imbalance that as I say, do intervene quite substantially in this positive discriminatory way.
Well, there are some preconceived notions about women and storytelling. Just like you said now, there is this category, this perceived category of women's stories or, stories about womanhood, let's say. Mm-hmm. Does this imply that all women have this narrow sense of the world? I mean, they just have their stories to tell, which is sort of maybe shoehorning them into one genre or one set of notion.
Yeah, I think that is a real problem. And I think you've seen that in the reception of Catherine Bigelow's films, where there was a real difficulty in how to categorize her because she was making films that were seen as, you know, male-oriented about war and so on. So there were articles about her being a muscular filmmaker. People didn't really know how to cope with it. And I think that is one of the problems. You know, there's evidence that women like to watch all kinds of genres. There's evidence now that horror films may be more popular with women. And that is actually one of the genres that has always been over-associated with men and with sort of teen boys in particular. So there are a lot of false conceptions, misconceptions circulating in the ether that we need to get beyond.
And it's a bit of a catch-22 situation. If you tell, women stories about womanhood, then you're accused of being too female or too sentimental. But if you do the otherwise, then you're competing in a male category, I guess. Much is being done to fix this. And, it seems that the situation stayed static. Why is this the case?
I agree with you that women always get punished. Whatever they do, they don't seem to win, and more so than men. They're often criticized. Sofia Coppola's been criticized a lot for her representations, for instance, her decision not to include a black character in The Beguiled. But it just seems to that they attract more censure than men. I mean, what can you do? I think that some of the initiatives in place have made a difference. I essentially think it's down to funding bodies to take the direct action. So we have seen a huge improvement in statistics for Eurimage films, those films that are funded by the Council of Europe's co-production scheme in Europe. And that's gone up to 38% share directors from 21% in 2016. So an enormous increase. And that's because they provide subsidies for a portion of the budget if you have a female-led creative team. And some nations are doing the same, but not all of them. Sweden's done really well with parity by such incentives. And another organization is Women in Film International, which has offered 10% for female-led teams as well. But we just need to see more of that. I also think that film festivals have a role to play. Some of the European film festivals pledged 50-50 by 2020. Hasn't happened, I'm afraid. What is meant by that is 50-50 in terms of personnel, jury members, but also awards. And neither has happened. I mean, you only have to go and look at the Cannes Film Festival website to see that, particularly jury members are still really male biased. And that's an important aspect, promoting visibility, championing women's work, marketing, changing perceptions in those more intangible, soft ways as well.
And some might think that those quotas or gender parity pledges lead to or might lead to tokenism. Should this be a concern, you think?
Hard cases make bad law. I mean, there are always pros and cons and maybe some downsides to any approach. But I think given the dire figures and the slowness and the high stakes, you know, it's the only way forward. So I think it's doing more good than harm to insist on parity.
All right, Mary Harrod, it was good to have you with us today. Thanks so much for taking the time to join us. British indie pop band Bastille is about to release another concept album. But instead of a colorful night at the party, see their last album for that one, their newest offering draws inspiration from sci-fi. Take a listen.
Bastille's Give Me the Future pays tribute to the Matrix, to Aldous Huxley's Island, and there's even Afrofuturism for good measure. This is a sci-fi lover's delight. The guys even give credit to COVID-19 lockdowns, a time they say felt like science fiction. In this song called No Bad Days, frontman Dan Smith plays a character desperate to bring a lover back to life through an android.
In deciding on trying to make something about humanity and identity in the context of technology, and leaning into the science fiction thing, it meant that musically as well, we could kind of really lean into a lot of the influences from sort of retro futuristic music, tunes from the 80s, you know, futuristic synths, and, you know, right back to the kind of like Paul Simon sounds from Graceland and Quincy Jones sort of big brass stabs and production.
But then what's with this song called Thelma and Louise? I mean, how futuristic was this 1990s film about two women running away from cops? Well, Bastille presents it as an animated video game dreamscape. And Smith explains how it fits the concept.
I think with tech and with the escapism in this album, it's about the fact that, you know, be it VR or the internet or films or, you know, or gaming or whatever, they offer this amazing escape, and they can be like these incredible communities. They can bring people together, they can give people a voice, they can, you know, they're totally inclusive in so many ways, which is amazing. But also they have a dark side, you know, they can be addictive. You can lose yourself there. You can find yourself exposed to potentially like not the most healthy ideas. Like it's not black and white. It's not binary. These are like complex things.
And Bastille's distorted light beam is just that. In its video, people use a device to transport themselves into a fantasy world. And the song goes, when I'm dreaming tonight, I can do anything. When I'm dreaming tonight, I can go anywhere. When I'm dreaming tonight, I can be anyone. So wake me up, don't wake me up. But overall, Bastille hopes to balance both technology's bad and good sides in Give Me the Future, and invites listeners to dance their way down the rabbit hole.
Cat owners can now get a 3D felt portrait of their feline friends. There they are now, and they're courtesy of Japanese artist Sachi.
When I think about how to present the uniqueness of each cat, not just the color, I would buy a great amount of felted wool. For example, I have dozens of types of felted wool just for the white color. I would carefully select the material from them so that it will look like the real cat. I'm extremely particular about this. I think that the moment when the cat's spirit enters into the artwork can be presented through the eyes. In that sense, I have been very particular about how to make the eyes. It was a very big event for me that the cat I made reached someone's heart, and this person wanted to adopt this cat. It's still a vague idea, but I hope to hold an exhibition with the theme of shelter cats in the future, so more people will take them in.
Francis Bacon liked to blur the lines between people and other animals. And now a new exhibition in London explores what many consider, well, hard to look at.
But how his fascination with these elements really went to develop the way that he represented the human figure in this signature contorted, often distorted features, distorted nudes, distorted bodies, really came from his very close study of animals, in particular animals in movement, and this kind of equivalence that he drew between animal and human movement.
Young told Spotify it's either him or podcaster Joe Rogan, and Spotify chose Rogan. The company has begun removing Young's music from the streaming service. He issued the ultimatum 2 days ago, upset over Rogan's false claims about COVID-19 vaccines. Rogan is Spotify's biggest podcaster, which the company reportedly spent $100 million to license. Peter Robbins, the original actor to voice Charlie Brown, has died. Robbins voiced the character in the iconic Christmas specials, A Charlie Brown Christmas, and It is the Great Pumpkin, Charlie Brown. Art Basel has kicked the FIAC Contemporary Art Fair out of Paris's Grand Palais. A Swiss group overtaking a venerable French organization is likely to send shockwaves throughout the art world. The venue had hosted the FIAC since the 1970s, but Grand Palais executives say Art Basel will bring more investment to the city. And John Lennon's son is auctioning off NFTs of Beatles memorabilia. The collection includes images of three guitars given to Julian Lennon by his father. It also includes handwritten notes about the song Hey Jude. Thomas Gainsborough's 18th century painting, The Blue Boy, appears at London's National Gallery this week, a century after it was shipped from Britain to the United States.
Blue Boy is not only one of the most famous pictures by Gainsborough, I think it's one of the most famous pictures in British art altogether. It is a remarkably beautiful picture. It's striking, it's moving, it's beautifully painted, it's enormously sort of romantic. Even when Gainsborough painted it, it was romantic because he was harking back to the sort of glorious painting of Van Dyck over a century before. So there's a huge amount sort of invested in this picture, and it's great to be able to show it here 100 years on.
Chanel has opened a new Atelier complex in Paris, where artisans from accessory suppliers create shoes, embroidery, and other handmade crafts. Here's our first look.
It's an enormous gift for us to be at 19M. It's an iconic place for artisanal crafts. It's a magnificent creation by the architect Rudy Ricciotti. It was ordered by Chanel to put together several artistic professions and to create synergy between them. It's really amazing, because if you need to work on jewellery, for instance, with goosens, you don't have to cross from one side of Paris to another, you just knock on the next door and it's done.
It's gestures and a know-how that are rooted in our history. It's important not only to preserve them, but also to keep them going, enrich them, sometimes transform them, enrich them as we just saw, but also to pass them from hand to hand.
Mais à se les passer de main en main.
How I Met Your Mother is still a celebrated sitcom, a decade after its finale. So, TV executives are cashing in on the show's nostalgic value. Yes, we're talking about the spin-off. And can you hear that noise? That's the critics who've already started to groan.
This is the story of How I Met Your Father.
Fans are gushing over the first few episodes of How I Met Your Father. It stars Hilary Duff as Sophie, who's looking for love in New York, just like Ted Mosby did in the original series.
I read the script and it was really just, it was everything you want a sitcom to be and everything you want to read off a page. You're like, oh, I get this. I get this character. I get this dynamic. I get these relationships and this group of friends. Like, it was really exciting for me.
Many fans on Twitter agreed. One tweeted, I went in ready to hate it, but I freaking loved it. And another one reads, it's actually pretty good. They modernized it for this generation and made it their own, while respecting the original show.
I was on another day before this.
And co-creator Elizabeth Berger says that's exactly the intention.
We wanted to honor the show, which is so beloved and we are fans of, but we also wanted to tell a story that felt really timely and of the moment in terms of what it's like to be out there and searching for love in 2022. It's been, I believe, 8 years since the original went off the air. So it felt like there's an opportunity here to sort of look at this chapter in a new way.
But most critics say the series isn't really offering anything new. Adrian Horton bemoans it's a stale sequel for nostalgia fans. And Melanie McFarland called it a sad cover version of a show that's best left forgotten.
It's a real pleasure. Oh my God. Pull over right here.
The original was praised for its hybrid shooting style, non-linear narrative, humor, and incorporating dramatic elements. But critics say this new series is a combo of generic dating sitcom writing, forced character types, and strained efforts to be racy and current.
In the future, just promise me you will change that part.
The original show did have one downfall after 9 successful seasons. Its finale was hated by almost everybody. So if How I Met Your Father gets cancelled after a single season, maybe it can stand out by coming up with a better ending.
You're crying? Or because you're going to town on yourself?
Crying!
Bro.
Both.
That's it on this episode of Showcase. Our YouTube channel, Instagram and Twitter accounts have more from the world of culture and the arts. I'm Elif Bereketli. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.